Hello, very good evening to all of you. Are you able to hear? Can somebody make a mention in the comment that you are able to hear? Hello. Thanks, Sangeeta, here for confirming that. Is it audible?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you very much, Harneet, for confirming. Welcome to the third episode of Teen Sawal, Teen Questions. First of all, let me thank the participants who have kind of given us good feedback and about the last sessions, how exactly we went in positioning ourselves for this particular program. So thank you to all those participants who gave us feedbacks in the last session. But before I start the session, there are a few announcements which I thought that I should be sharing with you. First of all, thanks to the management of BGS, National Public School, Bannergatta, Bangalore, for giving us this particular beautiful school premises from where we are going live right now. We could have done it from a hotel or other places, but then being education program for teachers, we thought that we will kind of take you around. In the second, I would also like to congratulate Sharda Jha, Harish Joshi, Sengunda Ramudan, Manju Matthew, who had contributed quite beautifully in the last episode by asking the questions. Going forward, some of the feedbacks and some of the questions which we missed out in the last session when we were doing with Mr. G. Balasubramaniam, who was fantastic again, who gave a lot of inputs. We have Vaishnavi Rajan from Kanchi Shankara School, Tirchandur. She said that she has picked up the idea of error analysis from how error analysis can be used in the classroom management, and they are very seriously looking at taking it forward. Then we also had Ms. Sara Prabha John. She had actually asked a question on creativity in students when stalled by, you know, Google and diverted to social media and insensitive to the violence which is happening around and students are trying to play around. And the answers which was given was very, very good. We are also happy that Anita Murlidhar from St. John's English Medium School, Vijayawada, she also asked a question on future classrooms, how we can enhance ethical values while ingraining knowledge in the children. The last question which came out, which we missed out last time, was when the future of education, if we have to give it in such large masses with outdated strategies, how will we kind of work on it? So Urmila Gulaniji, don't worry, we will kind of address some of these pedagogical inputs next session. And I'll be specifically addressing some of the questions with some of the Finnish experts once I'm at Finland next month during this particular time for this particular session. Going forward, you know, again, I would like to thank Dr. G. Balasubramaniam. The people who are still interested to kind of, you know, send in their question, please mail it at info@asktlc or WhatsApp on 9191087 4688. I repeat, 9108746888, or mail at info@asktlc.in. Some people also requested us very, very specifically that Dr. Senthil, what kind of initiatives do you do and how exactly do you go about? We keep doing certain activities which are again very, very focused towards education institutions, school leaders and school management. The next mission which we are taking is 22nd to 27th to Helsinki, along with our partner Skolu Group from Finland, who are helping us with this particular, you know, whole aspect. That's very, very important. The second program which we try to talk about, the administration. You know, I think it's very, very important that how do we try to nurture the office staff in the campus. So we are doing a program in Bangalore on 16th to 18th May in Bangalore. Then nurturing middle management, I think what we have felt, teachers normally move up to HODs, and HODs, they would like to become principals, but unfortunately, we don't find them getting any structured training program when they want to go up to the leadership. And finally, in the month of, we are doing that program at July 1st to 4th at Chandigarh. And then we have something called as Quality Vidyalaya Leadership for the young principals who have just joined and who are still wanting to, you know, position themselves quite better. That's happening between 8th and 12th. And final program for the open format, which we'll be touching, is Learning Mission to Singapore, where we have signed up with National Institute of Education International for owners and principals. So that is going to be something which we'll be touching upon. But I think I have a very interesting person who she has been my colleague, and also, you know, we have worked together on a couple of interesting projects when we were at Christ College. Those days it used to be called as Christ College. So I was talking to Swarnalata, Ms. Swarnalata here, saying that there is one particular topic where I want you to come in. Will you be able to come in? I think she said fantastically, yes, I think we should be kind of touching upon. Before I introduce her, some thoughts for you to kind of mull over. The topic is managing examination related stress, how teachers can help the students and parents. Because what we have found out in our journey, that one of the challenges which you know, teachers face, that they are not sufficiently equipped to basically handle such situations when parents do come in and ask them, saying that we would like to work like this, we would like to take the discussions forward like this, but they are not, you know, sufficiently equipped for it. So before I get into, you know, the session, I would like to just give a little brief about Mrs. Swarnalata here. Welcome, ma'am, on the show.
Thank you.
And I think it's a proud privilege again that we are together on our program.
Yes.
We have done cultural programs together at Christ College. So those are the days probably we have kind of, you know, worked. A very passionate teacher, first of all. Entrepreneur is something which has just, you know, which has just started, and she has kind of worked with children, teachers, higher education institutions across, and most importantly, she's a practitioner, which is, I think, very, very important, because a lot of people acquire degrees, a lot of people kind of go through it. And when I was talking to her about this particular program, she said there are a lot of good research which has been done, and students themselves came back with certain wonderful methods, how can we handle stress, and how teachers also have kind of come out with some methods. So I said that I think she will be kind of answering, and she'll be taking us through that particular aspect. But she is also a business partner with ENY audit company in Bangalore, Genpact Hyderabad. She is consultant with Better Future India, Edge Academy Bangalore, Optimum Healthcare. She is member of the advisory board on T. John College, Bangalore. She is part of Indian Institute of Psychology and Research and Jain University, Bangalore. And she handles undergraduate and postgraduate. So a teacher more, and a practitioner who is kind of taking the classroom experiences to the ground, and then bringing back those experiences into the, you know, in her own work. More than that, she is also on board of studies of Mount Carmel College, St. Joseph National College, Jayanagar, JNC, and she is also part of Global Zen Foundation. Recently, she was also recognized for her contribution in the, Women's World. That's Wonder Woman World, an online portal which deals with women achievers. So she got recognized in February 2018, last year, on this particular same, for her work in this particular space. So that was a quick introduction about the man, Mrs. Swarnalata here. But before that, when I was trying to, you know, sit across and trying to reflect on what is this managing stress or managing examination related stress, when we were trying to conceive this particular point, I was trying to divide them into three different areas. One was examination, stress, and managing. The examination, what I basically thought, and most of the theories basically talk about, is a formal test, you know, given to a individual or a person for his knowledge, proficiency in a subject, or any kind of demanding circumstances in a given time, in a given space. And it, in Indian scenario, if you try to look at schools, it is typically 3 hours a test which you actually go through it, through in to, you know, basically share his or her experiences or learning as part of it. So that was basically on the examination. Coming to stress, again, when you try to look at the general common man's definition, seems to be a state of mental or emotional strain which somebody goes through, which is resulting due to adverse or demanding circumstances for somebody. And third part, now examination stress is one part of it, but how does somebody manage it? You know, that's where I think the management philosophy of PDCA or PDSA basically comes in. So whenever we talk about managing, how do we plan to handle that particular situation? How do we implement whatever we have planned as part of that particular situation? How do we review whatever that we have planned as part of it will actually kind of, you know, work for people to take it a little forward? And then how do you take action on this for future learning to be sharing with your friends and your colleagues and then going forward? So let me, one of the basic things which we were, you know, kind of doing little research on this particular topic, we found out that unlike adults, I think the students, children are actually going through quite a lot. And I think when you try to look at the recent research which has been done by 2014 by American Psychological Association, they talked of this, they say that the students are going through much more stress than the parents. Because the pressure has been built by the parents on the students, and it was quite interesting to see that what the research also further says is that parents and teacher can look at some short-term behaviors and the physical symptoms of that particular child and helps them to overcome this particular problem. So this is all about the basic research which has been done. Let's get into the session and let me start the first question with Mrs. Swarnalata here is, why do you think that examination is considered as a stress in Indian environment? What are your views on it?
Yes, good afternoon viewers. Examination is something which every child faces right through the school atmosphere. But when they come to the 10th, why is it that, you know, it is so stressing? One thing is our culture. In our culture, we place a lot of importance on what the child is going to do in the future. Now, examination and the results of the examination are considered very, very important because this gives, or rather the marks determine where the child is going to get his admission. Let's say a child is doing his 10th standard examination. Where is the child going to do his plus 2 or PUC, as we call it? Now, all parents, of course, they have their dreams for their children. And so they want very high marks so that the child can get into a very prestigious college, or what we call is a good college. And then now the colleges also take in students only based on the marks. They don't see anything else. That's how the system is. And so, you know, when the merit list is put up, it's according to your marks. And so unless you have a, you know, high percentage, you're not getting into this prestigious college. And if you see most of the colleges, their cutoff is so high, it has gone even up to 100%, which seems very unrealistic. But then, well, that is how the case is. And every parent wants their child to be in that particular college. Now, this is a very, very, I would call it a mad rush or a rat race, because they're not looking at what the child is capable of, what are the abilities of children, what the child is good at, what the child is interested in, whether the child would be happy doing that particular course. Nothing is taken into consideration, very unfortunately. And it's only the, you know, college, the name of the college or the reputation of the college or the institution is taken into consideration, and children are expected to score to get into that college, which is very unfortunate. And the focus is not on, enjoying what you do. The focus is not on gaining knowledge from your education. The focus is very market-driven, which, some organizations have played it very, strategically, and they have said that it has to be market-driven. Education is not for that. Education is, yes, for personal growth, for improvement in knowledge. Now, for example, students study, let's say even science, where are they creating knowledge? Where is knowledge created? It is not. And if you see today, there are no students who are taking pure science, no takers for pure science.
Yeah, actually, one of the researchers which is done by Tata Trust also talks about that the basic research itself is kind of going away.
Yes, yes.
And people, you know, with so much of common entrances which have been kind of given, and as you rightly said, the admission process which is being followed by the institution also need to revisit their admission process.
Yes.
So there can be some component on marks, probably, you know, that could be one of the methods, and there could be something on the personal interest of the child,
yes,
where the hobbies and the kind of work, yes, which is being done. I completely agree, and I think, yeah.
You know, more than interest, it should be the aptitude of the child. See, we all have aptitude. Let me take 2 minutes to explain what aptitude is. Aptitude is innate ability. It is like your height. You can't do anything with it, right? You can't increase or decrease it. We are all born with this innate ability. And when we have this aptitude at a high level, then if you pursue a course in that area, you will do excellently well. If you have average aptitude, any amount of training, you will reach only the mediocre level. And if you have low aptitude, any amount of training, even the best of the colleges, you will not be able to succeed because you basically don't have aptitude. Now, let me put across one question to all of you. Let's say there are 50 students in a class. The maths teacher comes in. She's the same teacher. The syllabus is the same. The book is the same. What is taught in class is the same. Right? The examination is the same. The questions are the same. But there are some students who can score 10%. There are some students who score 80. There are a few who score 60. There are a few who don't pass.
Agree. Completely.
What is the difference? Aptitude. So it's, you know, unfortunately, parents don't understand this point of view. They send children to tuitions saying that you go for a tuition and you'll get good marks in maths. What happens in tuitions is the children are coached to take an examination. So you coached and coached and coached, the same questions are repeated, you're made to do the same sum five times, 10 times, and then you end up getting good marks in an examination. But what happens later? See, this child who does not have an aptitude has done examination, as Sendhil, you were rightly pointing out, is just a 3 hours incident.
Correct.
And good marks in an examination is only an indication of the ability of the child to take an examination. Full
it's,
stop.
It's more of reproduction of whatever the
exactly.
teacher or
yes.
whatever that particular
yes.
you know faculty has taught in the
yes.
classroom, and how exactly he's kind of, you know, working.
Exactly.
On it. Yeah.
And unfortunately, this focus on marks creates so much stress for the child, you know, that you need to go for tuitions right from morning 5:30. God alone knows what time they go for tuitions. After school, they go for tuitions where they're just coached to take an examination.
Yes.
We need to understand that, okay, this child may not have an aptitude for this subject. Fine. So for what subject does he or she have the aptitude, and put them in that area? Now, let me tell you, there are no takers for MSc statistics. Do you know? But the demand, if you look at the market, is very high. All R&D of the organizations
analysis,
required,
analysis,
require
yeah.
statisticians. You don't have statisticians. Nobody is doing, because you have to do BSc Maths and then you do MSc Statistics. Nobody is doing that.
The
there are no economists.
Yes.
We don't have economists at all. Nobody is doing MA in economics. Nobody is doing research in economics.
Yeah, while sharing with you some time back, I said, no, that one of the challenges which we are actually seeing in India today is 85% of people have taken English and social studies as part of their B.Ed. program.
Mm.
So that means there are only 15% of people who are wanting to get into pure sciences. If 15% are going to get into pure sciences, what will happen in 3 years from now or 4 years from now, that we will not have science teachers at all.
Yeah.
And we will find an engineer walking into the classroom who has a little passion on part-time basis, will come and basically start teaching maths without even understanding what the CBSE's requirement.
Yes.
He will be able to solve a problem and basically help them. But how much he'll be able to understand the child and the child psychology and
yeah.
those things, I'm not very sure about it.
Yes.
But I think that's something which we also need to kind of, you know, build upon over a period of time. How exactly can we take it and go ahead?
So here I would like to stress that.
Just give me a minute, ma'am. Let me just reorganize this particular camera up.
Which I think is a question. Which
yeah, questions will come and we'll take questions here. So you were saying something about that.
Yes, I was saying that. So as a society, we need to, you know, have a paradigm shift in terms of understanding what exactly education is. See, India, if you look at our culture, early on when we had the Gurukul system, education meant something else. Every child was taught everything, but each one was picked up for their specific strengths.
Correct.
And then they were made to, excel in that. But now it's not being done at all. All of them are, streamlined into the same course, which is not at all realistic. How can everyone be an engineer or a successful engineer?
Correct.
Or how can everyone be, an MBA? Today the craze has gone for engineering. Today the craze is for MBA. Become MBA.
Yeah. So, Sandana, I think what you said is very, very important. Maybe I think the awareness on the programs, awareness for need for how do you somebody kind of, goes through this particular program. Now, many people even don't know that there is a BSc research program which has been done by Indian Institute of Science.
Yes.
And there are multiple options available and it is a four-year program.
Yes.
How many people are even aware of it?
Exactly.
I'm not very sure about it.
Yes.
But everybody would like to go to a regular BSc three-year program with an integrated B.Ed or something. And then they said, okay, I'm going to get into teaching. Fine, you can get into teaching. But if your foundation, if you don't have depth in the subject, I think that's going to be very, very...
Yes.
And the point what you talked about, the examination and stress. The first question which has come to me, Geetanjali Shivkumar from Ganges Valley School, Hyderabad. She's asking a very interesting question. Is it the exam that is intimidating us, the fear of results? Or the fear of results that follows is more horrifying?
Yes, it is the fear of result. See, very unfortunately, we are going completely against our culture because in the Bhagavad Gita, it says, Karmanyeva adhikaraste ma phaleshu kadachana. Do your duty. The result is a natural outcome of your duty.
Correct.
We are going completely against that and we are focusing only on the result. And we push... All parents push students saying, no, you must get this. This is what your goal should be. Instead of seeing the process of learning. See, if the process of studying is done properly, every child will find it very easy to sit in any exam anytime.
Okay.
But the process of studying is not looked at. Tell me how many schools today teach study skills for their students?
I'm not sure because see one of the challenges most when we see I have been doing these workshops and training across and you have been also doing. One of the common challenge most of the teachers across the country say is that how do I finish the syllabus? My belief is that your whole design for delivery of the program itself is wrong.
Wrong.
So when your program itself is wrong, how will you be able to finish?
Exactly.
Yeah. So I think how learning to learn,
yes.
How do I learn certain things?
Yes.
I think if that can be given, as you rightly said, we should be able to help the child to learn himself.
Yes. See, in small classes, what happens is the question is given by the teacher. The answer is also given by the teacher. And the child is only expected to by heart the answer and reproduce it verbatim in the answer sheet.
Yeah, because maybe I normally give this example of we have this bad habit of saying, asking children to repeat. A for apple, A for apple. Every time, you say A for apple and the child also says red apple, there's a green apple. He doesn't even know that there's a green apple exists. But whenever A says and if the child says aeroplane, the teacher is a little confused and says that, where did you learn this? Because I have not taught you this.
Yeah.
So expectation is apple. So what you rightly said is...
Exactly. And so what happens is, children are made to by heart. Now, let me give you the real situation. How many subjects do children have for every class? Six, I think, right?
Eight.
Six subjects. Each subject maybe has 10 chapters.
Around 10 to 12 chapters.
Okay, 10 chapters we will keep. So 60 chapters. Each chapter will have 10 to 12 questions.
Correct.
Okay, so 16 to 12, 720 questions. Is it humanly possible to by heart 720 answers and remember all the 720?
So, yes.
It's not possible. So you're not teaching them how to study at all. And then how can a child even remember? So you see what's happening, it is just drilling. All these tuition centers just drill into their heads over and over and over again and prepare just for the examination. I have students who, now they're in their second year of BA. We have statistics for psychology students.
Mm-hmm.
And when you tell them to calculate square root, they're like, oh ma'am, we don't know. Why didn't you do it in your 7th standard? Ma'am, that was a long time back.
Correct. So people are not...
So what is education? What you study in 7th, you forget in your 8th. Okay. What you study in your 8th, you forget in your 9th. Right? So what are you doing? Every year you just, by heart for examination sake, go vomit it there, regurgitate it and come back.
Correct.
And then you're very happy with the marks.
That's
because which is so silly.
Yeah, because at the end of the day, you know, the score is, yeah, I still remember when CBSE moved from numerics to, you know,
grades.
People said that tum ye batao ki kitna percentage of first,
exactly.
They are not interested in the grades as
the
such.
The parents, the students, nobody was happy with grades. They said, no, we want, because they want to compare and say, I got 96, you got 95.
Correct.
Which is not what, you know, studying is about. Your 96% does not tell us anything about your knowledge. It only tells us about your capacity to take an examination.
Correct. I also agree, ma'am. See, one of the things I think CBSE also, you know, in the initial stages when CC concepts like CC was actually brought in.
Yes.
Was a fantastic tool to basically do an assessment of a child.
Continuously.
And
yes.
Then, and that's what formation.
Yes.
When the child was getting formed,
yes,
in forming in one particular, yes, form, you were kind of giving him the differential, yes, inputs for different children,
yes,
to take the learning further. I think that was. So let's go to the second question.
I would just like to add there. See, the policy makers thought about, and it was very, very good, this continuous comprehensive evaluation of children. Very good, helps in continuous improvement of the child. But what happened is, when this policy percolated down to the teacher who's actually supposed to do it, the teachers were not trained properly. They were not told about the philosophy behind it. So what happened, I remember, because at that time I was part of a training group and we were training the teachers.
Mm-hmm.
The teacher only felt that, oh my God, this is a one more work for me.
Okay.
In addition to what I do. Now I have to do this also. So they did not understand the philosophy behind it. They were not told how to do it. Right? So it does not happen as a continuous comprehensive evaluation at all.
Correct.
Rather, the teachers keep it as a, you know, a threat. So they keep it with them and say, now you're not doing this, I will, you know, bring down your marks in the internal assessment.
Correct.
Unfortunately.
That's the whole challenge. And I think I have the second question.
Okay.
Which has come up from Mohammed Irfan, Principal and Director of Andhra Pradesh State Welfare Residential Society. They have this IIT and NEET Academy. His question is, I think it's a statement, and then he follows with a question. Future students not only need to be knowledgeable in his or her discipline, but also need a new sets of skills and competencies. The academic quality of teaching has been a matter of concern for a long time. It has been widely acknowledged that a simple memory recall archaic system of examination creates stress and anxiety among the students. Further, deep meaningful learning is not happening. The same thing has been said,
yes,
by Murli also here. He says that continuous learning is missing. It is clear that reforms in examination are critical for stress-free examination and to improve the quality of teaching. What are some of, according to you, what are some of the important drivers for reform that we could suggest to test real knowledge of competencies of students instead of memory retention and capability?
Exactly. See, here a teacher should understand that his or her role is that of a facilitator, not a teacher. I think first we should remove that name teacher and put it as facilitator, because when they go to class, as you said, they are waiting to teach the syllabus.
Correct.
Which is not their job. Their job is to see that the child learns. Is any teacher doing it? Do you see that the child learns? What are the methods that I use to see that the child learns? I'll give you just one example.
Sure.
You know, there are teachers who say that, oh yes, we do. We give surprise tests to the students. Okay. What is the purpose of giving a surprise test? So that the student is always prepared. I ask them, are the students prepared? No. How is the result after, oh ma'am, very bad, they never study, what else can we do? Now, my question is, your purpose of the surprise test is to catch the student so that you feel that at all times they would be, you know, learnt well. And
correct.
So, now, your purpose, if it is to facilitate learning, please do have a test, because, you know, tests in between do tell us, it gives us a feedback about what we are doing and so on and so forth. Do have tests, but not a surprise test. Tell the child, tomorrow I'm going to give you a test, okay? And tomorrow we will have from this chapter. Give them the questions also. Yes?
No.
Give them the questions. Mm-hmm. Yeah? let them learn and come.
Correct.
And, you know, now they know that it's going to be the same question. Give them just two questions, because in a class of 50, 55 minutes, two, if you have two essay type questions and the child, I'm just talking about, let's say, a 7th or an 8th standard student, two or three questions, give them the questions, tell them this is what is your test, you learn and come. So let them learn and come, right? And then they write in class. Yeah. Now what happens is the children know that, okay, this is what the question is, and they come prepared. There are some who will not come prepared as usual. Now, this is how you facilitate learning. So a child who's got good marks, you can always, you know, appreciate the child and say, hey, good.
Recognize that particular
child. Yes, and so what happens, the child is more motivated to come prepared the next time. Once they know that this is how it's going to happen. Plus, there's, you know, teachers have this habit of saying, oh, they copy. Yeah, I'll tell you why they copy. Because one is they want marks, second is they have not studied.
Correct.
So they want the marks, but they don't know how to get it. So they copy.
Sort right? Of, basically.
What you need to do is class test, when you want to facilitate learning, make them sit in groups. They discuss and write the answer.
Yeah, this
so
is
the child, so the group creation should be done in a smart way where you have a bright child, an average child and a weak child without them knowing it.
Correct.
You don't inform the children that this is how it's done. Do it. The bright child would know the answer. Right? They all discuss. In this process, the weak child also learns from the bright child. And all of them write the answer. And what happens is, all of them will get good marks. All of them are motivated.
Yeah, but why? Where is it written that an assessment or an examination has to be always in a written form?
Yes.
There is nothing like
that. Nothing. Let them have discussions.
Correct. So the problem is that, that's where I think I was, you know, when we were kind of looking at this topic, I was thinking that if teachers are not sufficiently equipped on assessment methods, and then the management should support them to do those assessments, try those assessments in their institution, rather than trying to look at some, you know, because immediately the question will come, evidence of learning, how will we show? Evidence of learning need not be only through a written form.
Exactly.
It can be through a activity which has been done by the child, a rhyme written by the child, a recreated theory or a recreated story, a drawing of a, you know, creating a cover page based on a story, whatever he has read. So there could be different methods. But unfortunately,
I said we need to have a paradigm shift.
Correct.
As far as teachers are concerned, first is they should understand their role is not to teach.
Correct.
Because they just teach and go without even seeing if any student has taken in what they have taught.
Correct.
No, I have finished this chapter. It is done in class. Has the child got it?
I'm not very
Nobody
sure.
Nobody asks that question.
Yeah, I have completed my portion. You know, because at the end of the day, I have to go back and report to my coordinator, class coordinator and subject coordinator.
Exactly.
Asking him and her, saying that I have completed. See, I have marked so many months, I'll complete. And I've completed though, I've done my role.
In fact, you know, when we use these different pedagogical methods, actually the load on the teacher goes down. There are some lovely methods where, you know, a very boring piece of essay, let us say, is studied by every student in the class without the teacher having to, you know, read it out or anything like that. There are very beautiful methods.
Yeah.
So teachers need to learn these new techniques.
It's not teaching.
So one paradigm shift is that. Second paradigm shift is the teacher should not go into the class saying, I am the expert. See, today there is knowledge, information very readily available.
Correct.
Right? So your duty is not to just transmit information. Your duty is to see that new knowledge is created. So let us not get into the class thinking, I am the expert and I know everything. Right? Children definitely know much more than us. So it should be an interactive class. And then, you know, the third thing, pin drop silence in class means that the class is not active. The brain is shut down. There should be a lot of noise in class. That is an active class where the windows are open, windows of the brain are open. So there's a lot of paradigm shifts which has to happen. And there are a lot of methodologies which are available, techniques which are available.
See, flipped classroom was also, you know, with the right thought, flipped classroom, it's also a very good tool which teachers can actually use. They give a topic, children go, do their own research. Come back to the classroom.
Yes.
And who says that it has to be used with technology? There's no necessity of using of technology.
And you know, when they do this, the child never has to study that part for the exam. this has been the feedback from the students. Okay. That ma'am, where you give us an assignment and we do the presentations in class, mm-hmm. they don't have to study that for the exam because they are the ones who have read through, they have researched it, they have found the points, and then they don't have to study it for the exam.
Correct. I have some good comments. I think Mukta says that we'll try the group test. Murli also says that group test, great tips. Thanks, ma'am. Then good idea, we'll try. Meenakshi Sundaram also is making a comment on that particular part. The next question which has been asked is by Dr. Maula Devi. She is Academic Council Member from Velamal Vidyashram Chennai. She has, you know, three components. One, she is asking, tricky and twisted questions make even a smart student stressful at the last moment. Why exam paper setters are not bothering about that and prove their talent in doing so? I am sorry, Dr. Maula Devi. If we are don't prepare your students for examination, give them the maximum inputs on the concepts. Yes. Let the question be asked from any corner.
Yes.
The child should be able to answer. I think that's something very, very important. One second question she is asking is last minute study helpful to students? Would you like to say anything on
that? Yes, when you say last minute study, if you're talking about the day before the exam, no. The day before the exam, the child should be playing, just running around, not studying. Just the day before the exam. If that is the question, if last minute study is talking about just 1 week before they start studying, then there is a flaw in the methodology of study itself, because last minute is only for revision, last minute is not for studying. So both ways, whether it's the previous day or just a week before, it's not helpful to students. Before exams, it should just be a revision. So I know it, so I'm just going through it in a very easy manner. I'm not sitting and studying now.
Yes. Just to supplement what you have just said, see, there is Dr. Maula Devi, there is a very interesting tool called as infographics. You create mind maps, you create infographics based on child's own approach to one particular concept. If he likes a cat, he likes a dog, he likes a tree, he likes a car, he likes a Superman, let him use those characters and put the information around it and make one page note, one page infographic, which he or she can just, the child can actually go through just before the examination and walk into, because it's going to be more connecting to the concepts what he has already gone through in the way what he or she basically likes.
Yes.
And the last question what she's asking is, any new technique to remove the exam fear? Anything you would like to add on it?
Any new technique? I think she knows some techniques. But school, I think a student should be... the teacher should be in a position to help students in developing their emotional resilience. This is an ongoing process.
Correct.
It can't happen just before the exams. So it should be a part and parcel of the teaching itself, that they develop emotional resilience in the students, in their students. So they can face, because exam is a stress. We are not negating that. But children should be able to deal with it.
Yeah.
And how to deal with it is something which happens as an ongoing process. So this is where I think every teacher should be trained in life skills, so that they can impart it to every student.
And that's where I think, I completely agree with you that it cannot be another, a value education classroom kind of a thing where you do another value education class or another, skill class, and then you try to, it has to go with the teacher. It has to be seamlessly seen and experienced by the child, that he or she is able to kind of, work on that. I think that's a very, very important point what you have basically touched upon. The next question is, Samudan, she is asking from Bangalore. The exam stretch starts in the month of February. So almost children, parents, teachers have to go through the pressure for 2 months. We are squeezed, smashed, so do we have a solution for this? A peaceful mind for all of us.
Yes, I definitely would like to answer this question. See, children definitely are stressed out. My question is, why are the parents and teachers stressed out? Who's taking the examination? The child. Now, teachers add to the pressure. Parents add to this pressure. Now, what will a child do? The child is only 16 years old. A 10th standard student is 16 years old. Don't you think the role of the teachers and parents is to support and encourage rather than add to the pressure which already the child has.
Correct.
So I don't understand why parents and teachers have this pressure. Main thing is they are focusing on the performance of the child instead of that. Please focus on the process. Focus on how the child can go about. And then here, okay, I have a few tips. This comes from a student herself.
Sure.
She's a 12th standard student, 10th standard student, and she says, one request to the teachers is, please don't convert our physical education class into a revision class.
Or portion completion class.
Yeah. See, physical education itself, I don't know in a week how many classes they have, maybe two or three.
Thanks to CBSE, now they have at least made sure that one every day should be given. That's
good.
A new rule.
That is what should happen. One every day is necessary. And that too, you convert it into a revision class. Please, teachers, don't do this. What are you doing in your class in the allotted time? Why do you need the physical education class for your revision? You think about that, right? So it just shows, reflects on your efficiency or non-efficiency. Yeah? Right.
So
that is one thing. And parents, again, parents, I have a list of things written here. First is, be empathetic. Understand that your child already has pressure. Because today there's a lot of peer pressure. There's a lot of pressure from school also to perform. You don't add to it. Now, there are many parents who say, no, we don't pressurize. But you don't understand it. You do it very indirectly. Now, for example, there was this child, 10th standard, he was studying. And the father, night, 11 o'clock, he comes and says, Beta, this is milk for you with the haldi and, whatever. Now, this is the same father who otherwise at 11 o'clock sits and watches news on the TV. But just because his exams are going on, he comes. This adds to the child's pressure. He says, why is Papa behaving like this?
Correct.
Yeah.
Maybe
so indirect
abnormal.
Pressure. Yes. And, the parents say, no, we are not pressurizing. But the mother is, talking to others and saying, see, this time I will tell Mrs. Khanna or Mrs. whoever, I'll show her that my son can get more marks than her. This the child overhears and the child says, oh my God, what will happen if I don't score?
Correct.
So you are indirectly adding pressure to the children. Please don't do that. Be very supportive, but not interfering, right? Do not interfere. Do not pressurize. Encourage your kids. In fact, school students have said that encouragement, both from teachers and parents, makes a lot of difference to them. They say it is, it reduces our pressure when we are encouraged.
Correct.
So please encourage them and, say positive. I'll give you one example. A mother is sitting with a child. This is in a railway station.
Okay.
And there's somebody sweeping, the sweeper is sweeping, and she's telling the child, if you don't study, that is what you will become.
Yes.
Okay. And there's another mother, another child, and that mother says, but if you study, you will be able to help these people.
Okay.
Now that's the way you need to talk to your children, right? Please talk positively, please encourage them. Don't say, if you don't study, this is what you're going to do. Tell them what will happen when they study well.
Yeah, we have
instead of saying yes. And yes, please let them have adequate sleep. And do not take personal responsibility for their examination. All parents, you take responsibility. Don't do that. It is the responsibility of the child. It is because you take responsibility that you are stressed up. And that,
gets released on the
yes,
child.
Yes, yes. And the child gets infected with stress. Right?
Yeah.
So don't take that personal responsibility. Behave normally. Let the home be normal. 10th standard, the moment that, it's December. Why February? December itself, everything starts. You see, they'll cut off the cable. The child is stopped from all his play. Or her play, or dance class, music class, everything is stopped. Nothing happens. Only studies happen. Is it realistic?
It's not, because he's suddenly cutting off
exactly.
Certain things also puts
it is not.
You
the child should play, the child should go for music class, dance class, whatever the child has been doing, all that. Because that is where the brain gets its relaxation from. So please don't stop the play, don't stop the extracurricular activities in the 10th standard, and let not the house behave in an abnormal way. Everyone is sitting quietly because there's one child who's studying for the 10th standard exam. Don't behave like that. Please behave very, very normally. It helps the child. That's how you encourage.
Just wanted to extend
yes.
Your point of parents to teachers. Because what I find in many schools is that they are trying to, 9, 10, 11, 12 children cannot have, they cannot participate in any of the activities which are being done by the school.
Oh my God, that is so wrong.
So it is such a thing, and these children, when we, because I work with a lot of schools, and when we see this, I think it's quite disturbing. The child is not able to participate in a, you know, moon activity which is being done, or a sports activity which has been done. And he says that he's, even farewells are not being given in some schools. So I'm quite, you know, disturbed that why should you get into this kind of a situation where people need to look at it.
And yeah, so you're behaving as if examination was a very abnormal situation. That is what causes stress. Examination is a very, very normal situation, right? Children have been taking exams for the past 10 years.
Correct.
Now, the 10th standard, suddenly why does that examination become, you know, stressful? It's because we create all these...
We have just around 5 minutes left, but we have a lot of questions coming in. We have Harish out there who talks about the reforms. Harish, if you, you know, play this video back, you'll be surely able to get those answers. We have kind of suggested, but one of the very important thing is that CCE itself is a big loss to all of us in the academic community. We need to change the methods, and a lot of hands-on activities has to be given to the child. So that's something major. We have Freddie Fernando who takes, dear teachers, please don't teach students. Make them to learn from you. I think, thanks, Freddie. We have Prakash Gupta. He talks about the tests again. I think he is still wanting to experiment the test. If the students are allowed to discuss and write the answers, how to ensure that the students writing the answers have actually learned an answer?
Over a period of time, they will learn.
Correct.
See, what happens is the weak student who never does not have the motivation to learn, paired with this, let us say a good student, writes the answers after discussion, this child also gets marks, and looking at that, he's so motivated. Next time, they do it and they learn. Peer learning is very, very effective, let me tell you. Mm-hmm. Rather than teacher teaching, peer learning, very effective, because they do it on their own level. So peer learning is effective. It has to happen as an ongoing process. Not just one test will not change any child.
Yep.
As an ongoing process in the entire school, this is how tests should happen. You just wait and see. They will wait. They'll say, ma'am, when are you giving us the next test? They'll wait for it.
Yeah, Prakash.
That's what will happen. And they'll start falling in love with learning.
Prakash, just to, you know, add what Ms. Swarlata here has just said, there is something called as peer assessment process, self-assessment, peer assessment, if you can actually introduce in your classrooms. I think that will be a great tool to basically look at it. Every child not only writes the answer, but does a correction of his or her own answers and scores the marks for it, and then tries to identify why he thinks that he should be given so much marks. But then there is a swapping of the answer sheets, and then you take the answer sheet and go through the child, the friend, his or her friend will also do the analysis of the same answer, that if he was supposed to give, how much score he will give, and if he would have given that score, for getting that score, what would have been the expected answer. So this is something which I have experienced myself. I think I've gone almost like around 6 times now to Finland, and every time when I go, I try to go and observe this peer assessment as a tool. I think it's a fantastic tool. You must try. And Prakash, I have one more suggestion for you. If you can actually try it out, let the children prepare their own questions.
Yes.
Let them make their own question papers. Because we think that only we can make question papers. No. You don't require a heart, you don't require a PSA. You allow the child to make a question paper and try it out. I think you will be able to get surely.
In fact, that is part of the study skill. A child should make his own questions and find the answers from the textbook.
Correct.
If they study that way, they never forget. They should create the questions. That's so damn important.
Okay, then there's some question by Meenu. She says that more than children, why don't we admit stress comes from parents? Yes.
Yes.
I think it's already agreed, Meenu. I think Meenu is from Satbal Mittal School from Punjab. I have Sangeeta Anoop. She says, can I know the importance of handwriting in learning? Is that the handwriting plays a major role? Sangeeta Anoop is basically talking about any points for her.
Okay. See, handwriting starts from a very small class. Okay. And we should allow the child to use the hand which he or she is comfortable with, not force the child to use the right hand. Okay. And handwriting comes from writing in the 4-line notebook and in the 2-line notebook. Now, whether handwriting has a direct relationship with learning is no research on it as such. Okay. All your famous doctors have, I think, terrible handwritings, so that is not an indication of learning as such. But yes, handwriting does make a difference, because when you correct, you know, especially when the answer sheet is corrected, good handwriting definitely, you know, creates a positive mindset in the teacher who is correcting also. But whether it has any effect on learning, I wouldn't be saying anything about that, because there's not much research on that.
Yeah, Sangeeta, I just wanted to add that I think it's only you know, one of the researchers which talked about that Indian parent and Indian curriculum. I think they are saying it is very, very over ambitious. That's where I think even by grade 3, they expect them to start good print writings and all. I don't understand, because I have also been a teacher. You are not asking the child to write a sports certificate or a co-curricular certificate. You know, you are expecting him to put his her thought in a best particular possible form. I think that makes you know, a session very, very
important. And again,
important.
This is another aptitude. We call it a psychomotor aptitude. Okay, so not all children can have good handwriting. Huh. And let's not force all children to have good handwriting, right? As long as it's legible and neat.
Correct.
I think we should be happy with that. This is also an aptitude. So you can't do much about it. You can't force children to, you know, come up with excellent handwriting. It's a basic aptitude. It's a psychomotor coordination, we call it.
Sure. Bona, thank you very much. I think she says wonderful ideas. Freddie also says wonderful, keep doing good job. Manisha Singh basically is talking about transformation from telling technique to asking technique can make better learning. Thanks Manisha for that particular input. Now let me go back to the again questions. I have some questions from Ganesh. Ramakrishna from Chinmaya Vidyalaya Tirchi, he says, what are the ways to bring passion towards exam among students in spite of various attractions and distractions? They don't
take. Give them the systematic and psychological. Exactly.
Approach.
See, to bring a passion, not towards, I wouldn't say passion towards examination, I would say passion towards studying, right? See, this will be a collaborative effort of the teachers, parents, school and students. It cannot happen by one alone. The passion definitely can be created. One is, we need to understand that each child is unique. No two children are the same, right? This, both the teachers, the parents, the school, the child itself should admit. Then encourage, you know, students in what they are good at.
Okay.
Yeah. And this will, now, for example, when a child is good in sports, the usual response by both the teachers and the parents is, haha, it's okay, you're good in sports, but that's not going to take you anywhere. Oh, you don't score marks. Now, come on, the child is good in sports. Why can't you encourage? And then you see, when you encourage, the same motivation will come towards studies also. Now you're creating that repulsion because you're not even encouraging what the child is good at, basically.
Correct.
The child is good at music, you say, that is okay, that's your extracurricular activity, keep it as a hobby, but no, you have to score marks. So entire focus is only on marks.
Okay.
Which is what we need to change in order to create passion in children for studying. I won't say passion towards exams, but passion towards studying.
Okay, I have a very next question. Ganesh Nagraj, he's the director with Vestas Chennai. He's talking most appropriate topic in today's context. Stress is a common for the parents, not just in India, worldwide. How can exams become more of feedback tool instead of mere score? Poor score should also carry
correct
answer, action plan for. I know that Ganeshan is basically a quality professional. He also talks about parents' assessment score should also be part of students' overall score ranking.
No, let me tell you something. See, exams are a feedback. Examination system was started basically to create a feedback system.
Correct.
We converted it into something else. What is an examination? You study something, at the end of it, you're assessed to find out where you stand in terms of how much you've learned and how much you still have to learn. So if a child, let's say, scores 45 marks, it means the child knows to an extent of 45%. The child still has to study 55%. That's all. That is what it is meant to be. we have made it something else. We have made it as marks as being the absolute measure of the child's knowledge.
Correct.
No, it is only a feedback to tell you where you stand. If you score 60%, it means you know 60% of what you should know and you still have to do 40%.
Correct. I have the
next. It's a feedback.
Yeah, thank you. I have another. See, questions are pouring, but I have to take those questions which have come first to us through email and WhatsApp. Others, we will kind of try to attend. Which we have already exceeded by 5 minutes, but I think it's a very important thing. We will, no more questions, but we'll try to answer the questions which have already come in. Principal from Coop Public School, PU College from Gonikopal, he basically is asking, children by and large begin serious study before the exam, so automatically stress builds up. What teachers can do to motivate the children to do their study on a regular basis and make study fun? The root cause of examination tension in all children is due to procrastination. How do we help them?
Exactly, because throughout the year, our focus is on the exam.
Correct.
Instead, it should be on the process of learning. And we should make the process of learning so interesting. As I told you, when you conduct group tests like this, like the way I told you, you know, give them the question, let them come prepared, and then, you know, they write the answer together. Every time the group has changed, they discuss and write the answers. It would be so fun for the students. They'll say, ma'am, can we have a test daily?
Okay.
You know, it becomes fun for them. And then tomorrow's an examination, they are quite prepared because they know everything.
Correct.
So there are many pedagogical techniques, you know, specifically where you can make studies fun and children very interested. They wouldn't even hear the bell. They wouldn't want to go out. And then again, one small thing here is this classroom. The idea of a classroom itself is not very conducive to learning.
Mm-hmm.
Closed room closes your brain also.
Okay.
It should be learning spaces.
Okay.
So if you could have, you know, learning outside under a tree, it definitely makes it more interesting to the children.
So it should not, it need to see, that's where I think when people, there was a recent article which basically talked about that if you have too many, you know, questions, too much of, you know, things done in a classroom on the name of supplementing the classroom learning, it's also kind of creates some kind of, you know, distraction.
Exactly.
For people.
Exactly.
So we really need to see that how exactly can we build upon it. I have some couple of questions. Let me see if I can take those questions. It's good that I think people are Sangunder Amudan is basing. Hi madam, good evening, and good evening sir. I would like to tell you something about exams. It has become stress not only for children but also for parents and teachers.
Yes.
I feel like we are squeezed, and I think this question got answered. I think we will kind of touch upon it. Sangeeta, thanks again. I think SLCs are very, very important and meaningful, where the parent also experiences whatever the child has done over the month. I think it's a good tool. Minu is basically again asking one more question. Questions which they find should be on the same page of the book. My children always have postages which they keep putting on so that they are able to find the answer and they are clear what all they have to be done. So she's basically giving a reference. Can we use some post-its as bookmarks or, you know, page references which we can always open up and basically take up. So the second part of the question is, I have also a solution, because when they study before exams, they themselves are not aware what should be there, where they should start and how they begin. Freddie is also saying, yeah, Freddie, it's all about lifelong learning. So that's a very, very important point. My quick question to you is, now we'll just stop for the questions. Quick question to you is, what all three things that every teacher must do to ensure that before exams, during exams, after exams, how they can be in constant communication with the child and their parent, what they should do?
Okay, one is be morale boosters, boost their morale.
Okay, one.
Saying
first,
that they can do it.
Okay, so first and the foremost thing what Swanlata Yaji is saying is that we should be the morale boosters for the child.
Yes.
So teachers, the first message is, don't put pressure, your statements, and then don't. See, I've also seen in some of the schools that when I went to Singapore schools have something called as day counters, which have been displayed on their compound walls itself, which kind of puts them on saying that, okay, so many days are left out right now for the assessments to happen. So probably I think what you are saying is that give them the message that how exactly this to be. A morale booster is very, very important. Okay.
Second is encourage positive breaks.
Okay, create a lot of positive breaks. Can you expand that a bit so that the teachers can actually start
yes.
working on it?
So, even in school, you know, you have one period after another period. So, it's okay, now maths, then there's geography, then there's history, then there's science. No, let them have good breaks, positive breaks, because it's very important for them to assimilate what they have learned. So, the time for assimilation has to be given. It cannot be continuous one after the other. Right, and no assimilation happens. So time for, it's very physiological actually. I won't go into that right now. But the brain needs that time to assimilate what they have learnt. So positive breaks are very, very important, where the child just doesn't do anything, or rather does something completely different from what he or she has been doing. So this is for both teachers and parents. Please encourage positive breaks. And the third point, very yeah. important, allow students to find their own stress busters. What is a stress buster to you need not necessarily be a stress buster to the child. So what is the one which relaxes the child? What does the child find relaxing? Let he or she do that, right? That would be a very good stress buster. So it's very important. Let us not force our thoughts and ideas onto children and say, no, you do this, this is very good for you. I heard from somewhere or there's a research. It's okay, but for this child, something else could be a stress buster. So three very important points: be morale boosters, encourage positive breaks, and allow students to find their own stress busters.
Yes, thank you, ma'am. I think that came out quite clearly for the teachers. But my request to the school leaders, teachers, and if you are also a parent, then I think you need to look at that, how all of you need constant communication.
Yes.
I think that's something which is missing.
Yeah.
And half information when it is being fed to the child, I think the child is always built on the pressure, mera kya hoga, mera kya hoga. And also tagging, don't do it, particularly when it is on the scores. Look at his score, how he has done, how you have done. I think that comparison, try to just remove it as part of your, you know, basic. There is a belief system that competitive environment helps the child to learn better. But competitive environment should be a self-driven goal rather than a goal set by somebody else for himself,
yes.
herself, then to that particular individual. Yes. I think that's very, very important, that which we really need to look at it. And my last request to the management is that engage more parents to basically, you know, come into the flop, into the flap, and then try to see that how this communication needs to be there. And remove this particular myth that 8, 9, 10, 11, 12 is only going to be working. Just one last question which I always, you know, people say, when I should start focusing on my career? Is it grade 8 or is it grade 12?
10.
So
because you should choose what you want to do based on your aptitude, interest and personality. So in class 10, we do psychometric assessments, right? And then we tell them this is where your aptitude lies. So if that has to be your career, what should you be doing for your undergraduation? So what should you be doing in your 11th and 12th? So 10th is an ideal time for you to go meet a career counselor. I am one. So you can always get back all your parents.
Yes, I'll just share her number also in the comment now. Her mobile number is +91 988 66 18 011. Her email ID is swarlata.ir. I'm putting both this email straight away on the comment form so that you can always, you know, track and reach out to ma'am for seeking any kind of support for you or for your campuses, because I think it's worthwhile to get right people. My request to all the viewers and the participants today is that teachers, please don't try to take the role of counselors. Don't try to dump all that what you have suffered in your life on the child. Because most of the time, in the name of counseling, we are dumping our past experiences on the children, which is not right. The legal systems in the country is becoming day by day stronger. So get ready in case if you know, somewhere somebody has been done assessment and then your name has been referred by the child, and because of you this particular situation happens, get ready to be behind the bar.
Yeah,
so
yeah. People like us are here available, so make use of, you know, counselors like us. I'm a career counselor, I'm a psychologist, so you need to make use of the qualified people. who can help, who can definitely help.
Because traditionally in India, it's like, you know, if it is a village, the teacher, whoever is the teacher in that particular village seems to be the most knowledgeable person. But in the same way, people also, you know, suddenly who has gone through certain basic things, you know, and again, you try to give the same gyan. Because everybody looks at engineering, everybody looks at
need. And there is, let me tell you that today the scope is wide. The options are just innumerable. Right? So please don't restrict your child to one. I don't blame the parents. You do not know the options. That's why you're not able to tell your children. But we career counselors are here for that particular purpose. We will give you all the options, and there are some brilliant options which you will be very happy, because your child is going to be happy and successful.
And for teachers, I have a small request to all of you. Please do refer NSDC, National Skill Development Council. Every year they come out with a publication. Please do read that, because, and my request to the principals, if you are principal who is watching out here or a management watching out here, I think you must consider downloading certain material, giving it to your teachers, and instead of doing some generic repetitive sessions, please ask them to do. Second is WE Forum, that is World Economic Forum website. They also keep coming out with some beautiful publication. Other than that, UNESCO, you know, there are other, World Bank, all of them keep coming. So please do read. If you don't read the way you have been taught, don't try to teach that particular child whatever you want him to learn. So thank you very much on, you know, we have extended the session almost by 20 minutes more. But I think special thanks to Mrs. Swarnalatha here. Thank you, ma'am. Again, I think it was wonderful to be part of, you know, a discussion again for the students. I still remember that, I think whether it was Darpan or, you know, any one of those competitions which you used to do at Christ College as colleagues, I think this is something which was wonderful. And
yeah, I would like to thank the viewers, because their interaction was very, very good. Yeah, and they had, the questions were very relevant. They were thinking about making use of the suggestions. So thank you, viewers.
And thanks to each one of you. There are, again, I can see, you know, people are still online. The questions which we are not able to answer, we will try to answer in the comment form itself as replies. So there was one question which was very, very interesting, which I thought that I should be sharing. You know, schools have requested me, can we show this videos to our teachers also? I think you're most welcome.
You should,
because there's no copyright issue as such. We are more than happy, whatever ideas we have shared, it is purely based on our experiences and learning over the years. I think 30 years this side and 30 years that side, 30 plus years that side. I think we should be able to see that 60 years of experience, we are trying to put it together. So you are most welcome, because Father Laiju from Kochi had requested me, and he said that I have shown these two things, and he sent a small note saying thank you very much. We have started using these sessions also as continuous professional development for our teachers on Saturdays. I think please go ahead, use them, you know, fruitfully, reach out to the people and add value to every child who is sitting in the classroom, either last bench or first bench. With that, thank you very much, and see you again on next Sunday. If it is going, I'm going to be on Finland next Sunday, if time
next
permits.
Month. Yeah,
next month.
Next month.
Yeah, so every month, last Sunday, 3:30 to 4:30. If there's going to be any change, I'll surely send you a message on TLC app, on the TLC page, and the WhatsApp groups. Thank you very much. Have a great evening. Bye-bye.
Bye.